The idea of the closed mind is that there are some people or some systems of ideas that are insulated or immunized against the impact of truth and rational argument. What I'm going to do is I'm going to run through the stock arguments for the closed mind and hopefully along the way explode each one. A very popular argument for the closed mind is that people adopt ideas and maintain them because of emotion, specifically emotion that is disconnected in some way from theory. But my answer to that is that all our emotions are based on our theory about the world and our place in it. And this idea goes back to the Stoics, the ancient Greek philosophers, who argued that all the same thesis, that all emotion cannot be even understood unless it's encased in a theoretical context. This way of looking at things has been quite influential recently in the emergence of rational emotive therapy, which you may have heard of. To illustrate what I mean by how our emotions are controlled by our theory about what the world is like and what is happening in it, imagine husband comes back to his home, looks over the fence and sees a man aggressively approaching his wife with an axe. He immediately becomes angry, rushes into the garden, only to see that the man with the axe is actually fending off a dog that was attacking his wife. His emotions will almost immediately shift to a different kind of emotion. So that's just illustrates in a simple thought experiment the connection between theory or thought and emotion. Generally, I would claim that all cognition is emotional and all emotion is cognitive. A more specific argument for the irrationality of human beings or their adoption of ideas is what's known as wishful thinking. People adopt ideas because they want them to be true. They wish something to be true. That Marxism or communism is possible. People adopt that idea because they imagine that it's a wonderful possibility. And because it's based on wishful thinking and not a careful comparison of rational arguments, a rational argument cannot have any effect on a fanatical Marxist who has adopted Marxism and the idea of communism based on their wishful thinking. My response to that is to look at wishful thinking as a kind of a heuristic for dealing with knowledge or imperfect knowledge in a largely unknown world. We are infinitely ignorant and we're prone to error. We're fallible beings, and wishful thinking can maintain a belief so that it can be properly tested. Because you have to bear in mind that we can actually be wrong even about our direct observations. So perhaps we have a wishful thought, we notice a counterexample, but we persist in believing it. Now, you might think, well, that's obviously irrational, isn't it? Why don't you just abandon the belief in the face of the counterexample? Well, my point is, we may be wrong about the counterexample. Even our direct observations are theory-laden. They have a tentative, conjectural character to them. So I would say that it's a heuristic for exploring a largely unknown world by a fallible organism, which we are. But it's not, and that it wouldn't, it doesn't a it doesn't impose an absolute dogmatism or obstinacy in the belief. The amount or with which the person would adhere or stick to the belief, even in the face of counter-evidence, is stake-dependent, or it's dependent on the values at stake. It makes sense for very, if you have an important belief, to retest it even many times. So that's my response to that. Equally, on the other side, we have fearful thinking. You know, believing something is the case because we fear it. It may be the case. Again, it's a kind of belief that emerges where the stakes are high, where the values are important and urgent, so that the relevant theories or beliefs need to be severely tested. Yeah, the third argument is that ideologies or systems of ideas are retained independently of rational argument, because the people who have adopted those ideologies are locked within a linguistic framework or theoretical framework or a conceptual paradigm. You probably all heard of Newspeak, George Orwell's idea that in the classic novel 1984, that the state could create a linguistic framework in which the population's minds could be imprisoned. And this idea has probably been bolstered by the historian of science, Thomas Kuhn. And Kuhn had the idea that there were periods of time in the development of science where all the scientists at a given era were locked, as it were, into their paradigm of observing the world, categorizing it, and that scientists from different eras, if they were to meet, they wouldn't actually be able to understand one another. They would be talking past one another because their very concepts that they're using are not commensurate. So if Newton had met Einstein, according to Kuhn, they wouldn't understand each other. Another example is the thesis of Benjamin Lee Whorf, who held that different cultures categorize the world in different ways, and this is imposed on them by their shared language. So different languages and different cultures mean you have different thought patterns, and again, there's no way that they can understand each other. I'll read you this quote, because it's quite a strong claim from Whorf. We cut nature up, organize it into concepts, and ascribe significances as we do, largely because we are parties to an agreement to organize it in this way. An agreement that holds throughout our speech community and is codified in the patterns of our language. The agreement is, of course, an implicit and unstated one, but its terms are absolutely obligatory. We cannot talk at all except by subscribing to the organization and classification of data which the agreement decrees. Now, my rough initial reply to that is that all ideologies or linguistic systems or conceptual frameworks require learning. But learning if you involves a trial and error process. So there are always going to be Winstons who fail to learn the language or introduce inadvertently or by intention innovations in that language. So that, you know, Thomas Kuhn's idea and Benjamin Lee Whorf's idea that people can be locked into a linguistic framework doesn't seem to hold water if you look at the epistemological problem of how do you learn that language anyway. Someone might say, well, would it not be possible for, say, a state, you know, the thought police, to monitor deviations from the sanctioned language? And my reply there then is, what that does, it takes the problem of learning, this trial and error process, just up to another level. So the thought police themselves, they would have to learn what was the canonical language and what constitutes a deviation from that. With regard to Whorf's hypothesis that language determines thought or even our very perception of reality, it's largely been refuted. With regard to, for example, colour systems throughout the world in different cultures, there doesn't seem to be that degree of variety. There is variety, but it fits into the slots that are produced by our physiology of our perceptual apparatus, in particular the rods and cones in our retina. They mostly dominate how we categorize the world in terms of color. If a culture has two colors, that's black and white. If they have three, it's black, white, and red. If they have four colors, they have black, white, red, and either yellow or green. And that's how it progresses up to at seven. So if they have seven colors, it's black, white, red, green, yellow, blue, and brown. With regard to the relationship between thought and language, both Steven Pinker and Alison Gopnik, as they've done very interesting research on this, especially Gopnik points out that infants seem to be operating, pre-linguistic infants seem to be operating with a theory about the world, and that this is prior to both, you know, it's logically more fundamental than language. Another argument, which is quite common and can be attributed to Karl Popper, is the idea that some systems of ideas become insulated by developing what are known as immunizing stratagems. You have the basic theory, and in reaction to meeting counterexamples or counterarguments, the theory is slightly modified, or an extra assumption is tacked on to the theory, and supposedly saving the theory from refutation. For example, the standard prophecy or prediction of Marxism was that communism would emerge in the most highly advanced societies. And when that failed to happen, various Marxists proffered the possibility that there were countervailing factors. So you can see how you can play with that. You can maybe imperialism interfered with the emergence of communism. If you look at the problem in terms of the strategy of propagating a message through a population of minds and then from one generation to the next, it's a very poor strategy to save a theory in this way, because it either empties the theory of its original meaning, so you're not really saving the theory, or it encumbers it with excess theoretical baggage, which itself has to be learned by each acolyte, each propagandist. So the fidelity with which the message is propagated is impaired. A similar or related idea is that some ideologies make a distinction between what you might call the hard core, theoretical core, which is sacrosanct and preserved under all circumstances, and surrounded by what might be called a protective belt of hypotheses, which can take the deformations and modifications introduced by, or not introduced by, but provoked by counterexamples. But there are problems with it, not only in terms of how hard or easy it is to copy a message or propagate it, but there are logical problems, insuperable logical problems of distinguishing between what is the dispensable, supposedly the dispensable protective belt, and the core of the theory or doctrine. So you can never be sure by altering cosmetically the nose, you may end up damaging the face, or the core of the organ organism that this ideology is, and that's due to I applied that in the book from the work of Kurt Gödel and Alonzo Church, and in particular Church discovered that. And proved, I think it was in the 1930s, that you can't fully survey all of the possible counterexamples, even in kind, to any given doctrine. So you can't prepare systematically in that way by, having your core system and then clothing it in a protective belt. Blind faith is another interesting one. That some people adopt ideas or beliefs because they've committed themselves to those ideas in a kind or supposedly special psychological state called faith, that again is impregnable. It's completely sealed off from counter arguments. We've all heard people say, well, you will not convince me because I am committed via faith. Well, belief itself is not something that you can commit yourself to, actually, because it's an involuntary process. You can say what you like. You can say, I believe such and such. And you can make an avowal of being faithfully committed as a kind of a loyalty gesture to your creed or your church. But the human mind is constantly scanning the world and revising its beliefs in a process which is involuntary. We can only kind of get out of it by taking drugs or going to sleep. Sam Harris, in his book, The End of Faith, the idea, therefore, that religious faith is somehow a sacred human convention, distinguished as it is both by the extravagance of its claims and by the paucity of its evidence, is really too great a monstrosity to be appreciated in all its glory. Religious faith represents so uncompromising a misuse of the power of our minds that it forms a kind of perverse cultural singularity, a vanishing point beyond which rational discourse proves impossible. That's quite a strong claim, I think. And he seems to be swallowing this idea that belief is a voluntary process. You just decide what your beliefs are, and you either do it irrationally or rationally. You either compare and contrast different views and arguments, and then decide, make a voluntary decision, I'm going to believe this, or that you reject the belief. What I'm saying is that if you can research a belief more or less thoroughly, but the belief that you end up with at the end of that research is not really something that you have decided to have. Why do people say, you won't convince me? Because maybe they are tacitly aware of the power of argument to transform their beliefs in an involuntary manner that they can't really, they have no control over the impact of the irrational argument that you might present to them. It's an idea of Richard Dawkins that some ideas are like computer viruses that control our thinking, and we adopt them not through, again, we don't adopt them through rationally comparing alternative views and making a justified conclusion, but we just adopt them simply because they are the ideas that happen to be around, especially when we're infants, or I mean children. And so the ideas on this line of thought, the ideas that get adopted and copied and propagated through populations are not the ones that are truth-like or consistent, but they're just very good at making copies of themselves, like computer viruses. With the main problem, I think, with this is, again, we come back to the theories that we use, our mind uses, are prior, logically prior to the bits of language that we might, or statements or doctrines that we might adopt from our culture. And children come into the world already armed with a network of theories about, or expectations about, the world. So when a child hears their parent saying maybe a snippet from Islamic thought, the child ends up assimilating that snippet of the doctrine to her own network of theories. But then the children also have a rudimentary logic, so they already start working out their own implications from their own theory, their own rudimentary theories about the world. And these snippets of their parental ideas. And so they will end up saying, not just a photocopy of what they've heard, but they'll say things that their parents would never have said. It can be very interesting, very amusing. Finally, dumb decision rules that we seem to operate with. Psychologists have done a lot of research, in particular Daniel Kahneman, Thinking Slow, Thinking Fast. You might have seen that in bookshops. And the idea there is that we have these systematic biases that are just irrepressible. They just keep on interfering with our thought and our judgment all the time. My response to that is that to completely accept that we do have these systematic biases, and they're very interesting, but there's two examples. This one is called anchoring, where either you generate it or somebody else suggests it to you. For instance, you might be bargaining about the price of something, and someone suggests a price, and then what's been observed is that the rest of the negotiation tends to center around that initial anchor. So that's a bias that we tend to have. Another one is the ease of recall rule. So you tend to estimate the relative probability or reliability of something on how easily you can remember or recall events of that kind. For example, we think, most people tend to think that nuclear power plants have a far higher chance or unreliability, or there's a far higher chance of breakdown in a nuclear power plant than in equivalent high-powered sources, industrial sources of energy, whereas the statistics actually undermine that. And it's just simply because we remember more easily the dramatic images that we have centering around nuclear power. So my response to that is that it doesn't mean that we're close to argument or that we're irrational. It just means that if we're economizing on time, then it's good to have something to work with. And there's a methodological point to make here, that a lot of this literature assumes that you can't start with conjectures or guesses. But the Karl Popper argues, I think quite superbly actually, that that it's, you can operate with conjectures as long as you keep them open to rigorous critical evaluation. So you can pick which stocks you're going to buy by consulting tea leaves. You've started with that. But as soon as you've picked that, then you start to have a look at the information, look for counterexamples, and adjust your trading or your hypotheses in line with that. Yeah, I think that really covers the stock, the main arguments for the closed mind. Thank you very much.